family. We want to welcome you to Barren Road Baptist Church this morning as we join and gather on this Easter Sunday. I know it's not our traditional Easter Sunday. I don't think anybody has ever had an Easter Sunday like this, but I can't tell you how excited we are to still serve a risen Savior. And we ask that you would just join us this morning as we sing. And as we sing, He Lives, join with us as we sing.
And Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is with me, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. Along life's narrow way, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. Thine other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way.
So great to be able to worship this morning. Amen. I absolutely love that song, and I love the last part of this. The last verse says, "The hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find."
Yes, amen.
And we know it's not a selective find. If you seek Him, you will find Him. Amen. And it's so great that we serve a risen Savior, that He is able to be found this morning. If you will join us as we sing, "Christ the Lord is risen today."
Christ the Lord is risen today, alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply, alleluia. Where, O death, is now thy sting? Alleluia. Dying once, He all doth sing. Alleluia. Where thy victory, O reign? Christ has led.
again. We are so thankful that we get to join together this morning. But if you'll join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much. Lord, we thank you for coming to this earth and living a perfect life. Lord, we thank you so much for dying on the cross. But Lord, we know it all would have been for naught if you hadn't risen that day. And on that glorious morning, Lord, we thank you so much, Lord. And we don't want to just worship you today. And Lord, we want to continue to worship you, Lord, every day of our lives, that you are a risen Savior, Lord, and that because of you that we have a home in heaven. Well, Lord, I ask that anyone who can hear this or anyone who is watching, Lord, I ask that you would just continue to bless them. And Lord, help them to realize the blessing that we have through you. We ask that you would just bless this service for us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Him guilty and sentenced him to die. When the crowd heard the news, they shouted, "Crucify!" Crowned with thorns, they mocked his name and nailed him to a cross. He hung there till his dying breath. Day one, all hope was lost.
It is amazing what a difference one day actually made.
Amen.
It changed history completely, and it changed the future completely. And so we're excited that we get to rejoice in that that special day this morning. Join with us as we sing "Christ Arose."
Rose. my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with the saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much this morning.
Yeah. Amen, amen. Aren't you thankful this morning that he's still alive? Praise the Lord. Thank you for those specials this morning on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We're so certainly glad that you're with us today and ready to celebrate the wonderful resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We're so thankful to have everybody with us today. And I just want to be the first to say, Happy Resurrection Sunday. I know everybody else says Easter. I like to say Happy Resurrection Sunday. It's not exactly the way, as Christopher mentioned before, that we want to celebrate it, being separated and all, but you know what? At least we still get to celebrate it together through the wonder of modern day technology. Usually, it's the one Sunday of the year, and I like to point this out, that some actually attend service. Matter of fact, there's some people who a friend of mine, I won't mention his name because everybody knows who he is, he calls himself a C&E Christian. He shows up for church on Christmas and he shows up for church on Easter. And there's some of those folks that are like that. And you know what? It's going to be pretty hard for some of those people who miss out on today's actual attendance of church services, because now they're going to have to go 2 full years without gracing the doors of a church. And that's going to be really, I don't know, I really don't know how they're going to survive going a whole year without, or a whole 2 years without church. But as much as I wish that we were physically gathering together today, you know what? We celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ every single time we meet. And so it's all good and we'll get through it and eventually we'll start meeting again. And guess what? We'll talk about the resurrection then as well. But because we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ every Sunday, I chose this year not to specifically speak on the resurrection and to continue in our Acts series, since that seems to be pretty popular. But if you're one of those people who really need a resurrection sermon this morning, I challenge you to go to our app, Barren Road Baptist Church. It's a free app. Go on that app and just hit on the media and you'll see if you'll scroll down, there's a resurrection series. There's actually 4 messages you can listen to, and you can do that after this service this morning, of course, but you can go to that. You can listen to all the resurrection sermons you want and you'll get your fill today. But I also wish, I did want to point this out, because I wish that we could have had our Easter egg hunt this year. I also wanted to point out that some of you did a wonderful job of compensating for our Easter egg hunt. I know there were several of you who specifically took kids. Matter of fact, one person, Miss Michaela, took specific packages of candy and bags of candy and everything, loaded them all up, and she took them to everybody's house that had children and left them at their porch or left them wherever so that she could stay safe. And she did a great job with that, but there were others who were handing out candy, making sure our kids, I just want you to know, we really appreciate you doing that. Today, we come in the Bible to Acts chapter number 15, and it is here that we're going to find another reason as to why the Holy Spirit led Paul and Barnabas back home from that first missionary journey they had just taken after starting several churches on that journey. Their main reason for returning home was to report back to their sending church in Antioch of Syria, and they would do that throughout their journeys. It was this church who had sent them out, but they went home to share all of the things that had done, including how the Gentiles had been saved. But another event is going to take place here in chapter number 15 that I believe it's important for Paul and Barnabas to be at, because I believe it is going to be their witness and testimony which helps solve this issue. You see, now that Gentiles are being saved throughout the world by accepting Christ Jesus as their Savior, by the way, if you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile, we really had to expect what's about to occur here in chapter 15 sooner or later because of the topic that's about to be discussed. And that was this: since Jesus was the Messiah of the Jews, all right, I think everybody agrees with that, then the Jews were going to assume to expect any Gentile convert to now live like a Jew or according to the Mosaic law. In other words, all Gentile converts would now, they believed, at least Jewish believers would believe, needed to keep or live by the Mosaic law, which included all males being circumcised. And just to be honest, why wouldn't they think that? I mean, Gentiles who converted to Judaism even before Christ came were certainly expected to live by the Mosaic law. So why wouldn't it be just as important in their minds for Gentiles converting to Christianity through a Jewish Messiah to do the same? I mean, this would make sense to the average Jewish believer. However, though Jesus was Jewish and was indeed the Jewish Messiah, he was also the Messiah for the entire world. God told Abraham that all of the families of the earth would be blessed because of the Messiah who would come through his seed. We all remember that. Now, that doesn't mean, folks, that the Mosaic law was no longer important. It certainly was. There are still many things in the Mosaic law that we can learn from today. Here's what Jesus himself even stated in Matthew chapter 5, verse number 17. He said, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets." He says, "I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." That word fulfill means to complete. He says, "I'm here to complete the Old Testament law," which he did through his sacrificial death for the sins of mankind. Christ fulfilled that that which was written of him by the prophets concerning his first coming. That's what he came to do, he says here. But Jesus also brought something else with him. John chapter 1 verse 17 tells us what that was. "For the law," he says, "was given by Moses. But watch this, grace and truth came by Jesus Christ." You see, Jesus brought us a new age or new dispensation of time, if you will. He fulfilled the age of the law and ushered in the new church age or the age, what we call the age of grace. Now, grace has always existed. Even though Old Testament saints lived during the dispensation age of the law, they too were saved, as we will see here in a little bit, by grace through faith, because it's faith that saves. But I entitled this message this morning, "Adding Works to the Gospel of Grace," because we're going to see that that's what's occurring here in Acts chapter 15. Let's begin reading here in verse number 1. The Bible says, "And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren, and they said, except you be circumcised," there they are, "after the manner of Moses," or what was taught in the law, "you cannot be saved. When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question." Chapter 14, you remember, closed with Paul and Barnabas arriving back at the church in Antioch, which is where this particular scene is taking place. These men had come down from Judea, teaching that unless Gentile believers were circumcised, they couldn't be saved. Because Jews had lived under the age of the law all of their lives, transitioning over to this new age of grace was going to be quite difficult for many of them. It was an entirely new lifestyle for them. But I want you to know something. It's no different than for an unbeliever today. For the person who's been living under the influence of the world all of their lives, who now accepts Jesus Christ as their Savior, and now begins to live, hopefully, under the influence of God instead of the influence of the world. Listen, it's just as difficult for a new convert today into Christianity to transition as it was for a Jew to transition. And listen, age has a great deal to do with that. The longer someone has lived a specific way, the harder it is to transition to that new way of living. It really is. That's why someone who or the older somebody gets, the less likely it is for them to accept Christ Jesus as their Savior and to be saved. Why? They've lived their life all this long by themselves without Christ. Why do they think they need him now? And so they just get into this mold, if you will, or this rut. I call it a rut for an unbeliever who just doesn't think they need anything because they're making it through life just fine. Also, Luke says here that these certain men came down from Judea, and though they use Christian terminology by saying they can't be saved, these guys are not saved at all. These guys are false Jewish believers. We know this because in Galatians chapter 2, Paul writes about this same event where he ends up in Jerusalem speaking to the apostles about this very vicious doctrine or this teaching that these guys are bringing. And in verse 4 of Galatians 2, he says this, "And that because of false brethren unawares brought in, who came in privately to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage." He calls these certain men in verse 1 of our text false brethren. He says they came in privately and they're false brethren. That brings me to my first point this morning that I want to make about adding works to grace. And that's for us to beware, first and foremost, of false brethren. Throughout the New Testament, new Christians are exhorted to be on the lookout for false teachers, for false teachings, false prophets, false apostles, false brethren, as we see here, false witnesses, and even false Christs, as even Jesus said would come along. And listen, their intent is the same, and it's to deceive, to bring Christians under their bondage, to make Christians look foolish, or to chew them up and spit them out, so to speak, or to make a name for themselves. That's what their intent is. Ultimately, their goal is to defeat Christianity. And this is what false brethren are very good at doing. They make their doctrinal teachings sound righteous, and they make their doctrinal teachings sound sensible. But in reality, what they're teaching is not based upon the Word of God, which means it's not based upon truth, so it is not truth, it is false. We need to beware of false brethren. Why? Number one, they teach a false gospel, or they preach a false salvation. And let me tell you something, some of them are really good at their deceptions, especially if they have what they believe to be scriptural support, like these false brethren may have thought. You see, they believe they could point to the Old Testament law of how God's children were to keep his law and males were to be circumcised. I mean, that was written in God's word. But it was never written in the law, and here's the point we need to see out of this, that in order to be saved or to become a child of God, that one had to keep the law. It was never written in the law for that. Listen, keeping the law or obeying it never had anything to do with salvation. Even if that were true, no one on the planet, except for Jesus, of course, could ever have kept the entire law. Why? Because we've all inherited a sinful nature from both of our parents. But you know what? That's exactly what false brethren are trying to teach here. Not just to the newborn Gentiles here that are being saved, but also to any Jews who might believe that Jesus freed them from the constraints of the law. They want them to know, look, you still got to live under the law even if you're a Christian. They're not just after Gentiles to put them under the bondage of the law. They're also out to keep any saved Jews under that bondage as well. They're adding works to the gospel of grace, folks, which makes it a false gospel. And just in case you don't think that happens today, you're sadly mistaken. We're quite aware, specifically of the cults of Christianity, like Jehovah's Witnesses or Mormons or Christian Scientology or some of these other, I'll call them crazy, quote-unquote Christian religions. Their false doctrines are easy to detect for anyone who knows the Word of God at all. They're easy if you know God's Word. But they're only adding works to salvation. That's what they do, all right? But they're not the only ones adding to the gospel of grace. The Bible clearly teaches us in Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." The very next verse of that passage does tell us that we have been created in Christ Jesus to do good works. That means after we're saved, we're created to do good works. But verse 9 here clearly teaches us that works, deeds, or anything we do cannot save us. If there was something we could do to save ourselves, or even if there was something that one person on the planet besides Jesus could do to save themselves, then guess what? It would be possible for all of us to save ourselves if one person could do it. And guess what? Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Hey, there's your resurrection sermon. All of that would be unnecessary if we could save ourselves. You need to get that point. If one man could save himself, then none of us need Jesus' finished work on the cross for our salvation. We can save ourselves. But this verse clearly teaches us, not of works, lest any man should boast. We could brag about it if we could save ourselves. And Jesus, what he did for us, would be completely unnecessary. And listen, folks, there are a lot of things that's works today. Even in the church of God. You know, baptism is a work. It's something you do. Church attendance is a work. Doing good deeds for others is a work. Soul winning, leading other people to Jesus Christ is a work. A great work, but it's a work. Giving your tithes, your missions, and your building fund offerings are all works. Using your spiritual gifts for the glory of God, those are works. Teaching a Sunday school class is a work. And listen, I could go on and on, but none of these things, no matter how many of them we do, can save us. None of them. And yet there are those out here today, Christian denominations, whatever you want to call them, who teach that you must be baptized to be saved. That's a work. There are those who teach that you must speak in tongues to be saved. There are those who teach that if you do enough good works or deeds, and they outweigh your bad works or deeds, then God's going to let you into heaven. They really teach that. That's a false doctrine. There are those who teach you got to be faithful to church services in order to be saved. One of the saddest things I believe I ever heard was from a grandmother who said to her 15-year-old granddaughter, who attended church regularly at the time, told her that she wasn't saved anymore because she had missed last Wednesday night's service. I was just blown away by that statement. And I pulled that young lady off to the side after her grandmother got done with her, and I cleared that up for her. I told her that simply was not true. Folks, none of these things, though they're all good, are the gospel of grace that Jesus brought us that saves. It's not Jesus plus baptism. It's not Jesus plus church membership or Jesus plus any works of any kind. According to the holy word of God, folks, it's Jesus plus nothing, period. And I know, I can hear Brother Feibel saying, amen, man, preach it and run, right? And listen, I don't care if you're Baptist, Methodist, Pentecostal, non-denominational, Nazarene, Tangerine, or whatever, anyone who teaches otherwise is teaching and preaching a false gospel. A works-based gospel, folks, is a false gospel. It's not the one that Jesus provided for us. And you know, we act today like it's no big deal. We really do. But I want you to know, to Paul and Barnabas it was. Verse 2 says that they had no small dissension or disputation with those guys. It was an uprising. That's what those words mean. It was an uprising for them. And this is why I'm so glad that the Holy Ghost led Paul and Barnabas back to Antioch. They made it a big deal. And listen, so should we today when we hear a non-truth spoken to somebody else about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Man, we need to pull them off to the side and clarify that through God's word and show them how they're saved. Listen, I know we're all just trying to get along today, all right? And I'm all for that, but I'm not for teaching and preaching a false gospel. When we're presented with it, we need to make sure that people hear the true gospel of grace that Jesus brought. Well, the church at Antioch sends them to Jerusalem to discuss the matter with the other apostles down there. They don't send them down. They're still an autonomous church. They don't send them down there to get what needs to happen. They're still going to make the decisions their own. They know what's true, but they want to clarify it with the apostles down there because the apostles were leaders at that time. Notice verse number 3. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion to the Gentiles. Man, on their way to Jerusalem, they were telling everybody along, man, people just getting saved left and right, Gentiles as well. And they caused great joy unto all the brethren. Man, everybody was excited. And you should be. Verse 4, and when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church of the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that God had done with them. But there arose up, watch this. There's always that but in there. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed. These are believing Pharisees saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. Now, while the certain men in verse 1 were false brethren, verse 5 says that these Pharisees which spoke up were believers in the church at Jerusalem. That brings me to my second point I want to make about adding works to the gospel grace, and that is that believers also need to beware of unlearned believers, unlearned brethren, if you will. We not only need to beware of false brethren, we need to beware of unlearned brethren who might lead us astray. Because these guys were Pharisees, they still would have been looked up to in the church because of their vast knowledge of the Old Testament scriptures. And these guys, these Pharisees, agreed with those certain men, those false brethren, that Gentile believers also needed to be circumcised and to keep the law of Moses. Now, listen, don't start thinking here that I'm against the law of Moses. Even Paul wrote that the law was good, for it taught us of our depraved state. It was God's perfect standard of living, which is why no human other than Jesus could keep it. I'm not knocking the Mosaic law here this morning. I'm knocking anything that people want to add to the gospel of grace. By the way, if people had to do something to earn their salvation, it's no longer grace. Grace is something you get you don't deserve, right? If we deserved salvation because of our works, then we wouldn't need grace. We earned it. But these Pharisees, even with their knowledge of the Old Testament scriptures, did not possess the deeper spiritual wisdom of salvation by grace. They too were babes in Christ. They may have known the Old Testament law, but at this point they did not know the apostles' doctrine or the doctrines of Christ. Colossians 2:8 speaks of young Christians like these who may think they know more than they actually do. There, Paul wrote in Colossians 2:8, "Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of this world, and not after Christ." He warns them of these guys to beware of people like this. Even Jesus got onto the Pharisees for making their traditions more important than the commandments of God. But listen, the same thing happens in the church today. We assume sometimes that because a Christian is well off, well dressed, or well spoken and seems to possess a lot of worldly wisdom, that that means they also possess a lot of spiritual wisdom. And folks, it's simply not true. None of those qualities, being well dressed, well off, or well spoken, none of those qualities produce any spiritual wisdom, according to the Word of God. Do you know what produces spiritual wisdom? A great deal of study and meditation in the Word of God with the Holy Ghost as your teacher and guide. That's it. That's what will produce the spiritual wisdom you need. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, the Holy Ghost teaches the deeper spiritual truths of God's Word because He compares spiritual things with spiritual. The Bible says that the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. So just because somebody knows got a lot of worldly wisdom doesn't mean they have any spiritual wisdom. That's the point I'm trying to make. And yet the church of God today seems to be adhering more to the wisdom of the world. You'll notice in most churches, they're looking more and more like the world today than they are separated from the world that Christ separated them from. Then there are other Christians who think they're spiritually wise and that their words should be always be adhered to. Look, you need to be aware of those as well. You say, well, how do you know whether or not somebody's spiritually wise or not? Well, are they backing their beliefs? Are they backing their teachings with the Word of God? Or are they just giving you some kind of opinion or wise statement that they make? It doesn't necessarily mean that they're wise. If what they're saying is not backed up by the Word of God, they're not wise at all. That's how you tell the difference. But you got to know God's Word, if that's ever going to be possible. I'm sure these Pharisees, at least at this particular time, still haven't lost their sense of self-importance and privilege, which is probably why they spoke up. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. I love that verse that he says. Now, let's notice verse number 6. And the apostles and the elders came together to consider this matter. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up. I like the fact that Peter waited. You remember old Peter, whenever he really didn't know much? I mean, he waited here, and he waited till all the disputing comes up. Spiritually wise and older Peter, the apostle Peter, speaks up. And he said unto them, "Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us. And put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now, therefore, why tempt you God? I love this position that Peter takes. Why tempt you God to put a yoke upon the necks of these disciples, which neither our fathers nor were able to bear? Our fathers weren't even able to bear, and you want to put it on the Gentiles? But we believe that through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they. We need to beware of false brethren. We need to beware of unlearned brethren. And finally, in regard to adding works to the gospel of grace, we need to obey the apostles' doctrine. The apostles' doctrine. The apostles' doctrine is always a reference to the New Testament word of God. Apostles, you'll remember, were sent out directly by Jesus Christ. That's why there's no apostles today. People will claim to be apostles, but it's junk, folks. It's another addition to God's word. It's not real. Apostles were actually sent out by Jesus. That was a qualification to be an apostle. Their teachings came directly from him, who said that when the Holy Ghost was come, after he was gone, he would send the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost would bring to remembrance everything he had taught him. That's John chapter 14. And one of the most well-known apostles was Peter. And here we see Peter's testimony of the Gentiles' salvation. Now, Peter was known for speaking up, but in this case, he was an authority on this subject. For you'll remember back in Acts chapter number 10, when we were talking about Cornelius and all those things that took place back then, that he had led the first Gentiles to the Lord. By the time he got to Cornelius' house, Cornelius had a house full of people, and they were all Gentiles, and they all came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And that's the story that he shares here. He explains what happened. In verses 8 and 9, he says he bore witness that they too had received the Holy Ghost, and that there was no difference between the Jews and the Gentiles, because God had also purified their hearts, watch this, verse 9, by faith. And that's the point. He purified their hearts, he says, by faith. Remember what the Bible said back in Ephesians 2:8? For by grace are you saved through faith, not of works, right? They were saved by faith. They believed with all of their hearts in the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ for their sins, and they asked the Lord Jesus to come into their hearts and save them. That's what saved them. Mouth confession of what was in their hearts and what they believed with all of our hearts. Folks, that's what faith is. Romans 10:9 even tells you, and I quote this all the time, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. If you remember the story back in Acts chapter 10, the Holy Ghost came upon the Gentiles immediately after they received the word of the gospel of Christ that Peter had preached to them. They received it immediately. Then they were baptized. Then they started attending Christian services and gatherings together. And then they started doing good works for the Lord Jesus Christ. Not to be saved, but because they were already saved by their faith in Christ alone, as Peter says here. We're saved by faith. Now verse 12. Then all the multitude kept silence. Now, I think some of those Pharisee believers are probably wishing they hadn't said anything, because now I think they know that what Peter is saying is the truth. All the multitude kept silence, and they gave audience to Barnabas and Paul. Now, it's their turn to speak up, declaring what miracles and wonders God had wrought among the Gentiles by them. Here we see some more apostles' testimony. It's Paul and Barnabas' testimony of God's miraculous things that he had performed among the Gentiles. Listen, ask yourself the question, why would God do miraculous things through Paul and Barnabas among the Gentiles if he didn't want the gospel of grace preached to the Gentiles? Think about that. I mean, God used signs and wonders throughout the New Testament by the apostles to prove to those who were watching them that they were of God. Jesus did that. He healed and he was proving himself that he was of God. Jesus gave that same ability to the apostles. He gave them the ability to perform signs and wonder. Why? The New Testament isn't here yet. So he gave them the ability to prove that they were of God by doing these miracles. Well, why would he do that among the Gentiles if he didn't also want the Gentiles to hear the gospel? And that's the answer to your question. He did. He used the signs and wonders to prove to those that were observing, those Gentiles that were observing, that he had sent them. And finally, we see we need to obey the apostle James and his testimony. And he uses his testimony from Scripture. All three of these apostles are speaking up and they give their opinion. All of them are based upon one thing. Let's notice what it is. By the way, it is James who is believed to be the pastor here at the church at Jerusalem at this time. Verse 13. And after they had held their peace, James answered saying, "Men and brethren, hearken unto me. Simeon," or he's talking about Peter here, "hath declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. And to this agree the words of the prophets, as it is written." He starts quoting Scripture. By the way, that's exactly what you want and what you need to do. If you're going to make a spiritual point, you need to quote Scripture, because if you can't back up what you're saying with Scripture, then what you say ain't worth nothing. But he does. He says, "As it is written, after this, I will return." Here's what's written. "And we'll build again the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down." Now, at this time, the tabernacle of David was already back up, but that's exactly what had already happened. And he says, "And I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up." Why? "That the residue of men might seek after the Lord," watch this, "and all the Gentiles upon whom my name is called, saith the Lord, who doeth all these things, known unto God are his works from the beginning of the world." James goes on to say, "Wherefore my sentence is that we trouble not them which from among the Gentiles are turned to God, but that we write unto them that they abstain from pollution of idols and from fornication and from things strangled and from blood." Now, it may seem as if James is adding something here to the gospel, but he's not adding to the gospel of grace. He simply wants them to know how important their testimony is and that these things are not to be a part of their lives. As a matter of fact, these are things expected of every believer. To get away from idols. We're to have one God and one God only. We're to serve him and serve him only. To stay away from fornication. The Bible is clear all the way through about all of these things that he mentions here. But this prophecy that James quotes is from the prophet Amos. And it proves that the Gentiles who called upon the name of the Lord would also be saved in this new church age. That calling upon the Lord was what the apostle wrote in Romans chapter 10, verse 13, where he wrote, "For whosoever," y'all know it, "shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved," right? Did you know that this verse comes just a couple, three verses after Romans 9 and 10, which I quoted a while ago, where Paul spoke about whole heart belief and mouth confession for salvation? Listen to me, folks. Salvation is for anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord by faith alone in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. That's it. That's it. "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved," whether he's a Jew or whether he's a Gentile. The Bible says whosoever, that means everybody. By the way, adding works like this to the gospel of grace always puts more emphasis on us. You ever think about that? When you add any work to the gospel, then you're putting emphasis on yourself, and it's something you can do to help it along. You know what that means? That means there's less emphasis on the Savior. There's less emphasis on Jesus when you start adding works and you start putting those works are something you can do, so you're putting emphasis on yourself. You can't save yourself. It's by faith alone, in Christ alone. It lessens what only Jesus Christ could do for us. Here's what the Apostle Paul wrote in Galatians 1:9, and I'll leave you with this. He said, "As we said before, so say I now again." In other words, Paul had preached this many times. And here's what he says again. "If any man preach any other gospel unto you than ye have received, let him be accursed. Those are pretty strong words. Let him be accursed. Brother Morton, that's pretty harsh. And I know that that may sound a little bit harsh, but if you knew how many people followed their false gospel that they're teaching and preaching and ultimately ended up in hell because of that false gospel, then you would have to say amen to Paul's words. Let them be accursed because they're leading people to hell. But I want you to know something this morning. You've been given the truth in regard to salvation because everything I gave you this morning did not come from Roger Morton's lips. They came from the Word of God. They came from God. To be saved, all you need is faith. All you need to do is believe. You need to believe with all of your heart that you're a sinner. You need to believe with all of your heart that Jesus shed his blood to cancel your sin. You need to believe with all of your heart that God sent Jesus to come down here to die on that cross, to be buried, and then on the third day to raise him from the dead. You need to believe all of that with all of your heart. Matter of fact, Jesus said that was the only work that could save you, to believe on him. We talked about that last week. All you got to do is believe, but you got to believe it with all of your heart. Okay? If by faith you truly believe that with all of your heart, then whether you're a Jew or a Gentile, you can be saved from your sins. All you got to do is admit those things to God, that you're a sinner, that you believe with all of your heart that Jesus died for you, was buried, rose again, that his blood canceled your sin, and ask him to come into your heart and save you. Whole heart belief, word of mouth confession. That's it. You don't have to be baptized to be saved, although I think that's very important. You don't need to go to church to be saved, although I think that is crucially important. You don't need to use your spiritual gift that God gives every believer in order to be saved, although I believe that's very important. The only thing you need to do to be saved is to call upon the name of the Lord, believing those things with all of your heart that I just mentioned to you. And the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That'll save you. And all you got to do is admit those things. Adding other things to this gospel makes it a false gospel. Anytime. It makes it a false gospel. It's not a scriptural or biblical gospel that lines up with the truth. This is your truth. Only truth you have. And you say, well, that can't be. It can't be that simple. It is that simple. It wasn't simple for Jesus. He died on the cross for your sins. But he made it simple for us. Now, I'm not telling you that your life is going to be simple and easy from now on. I told you it's going to be a difficult time of transition for you. Especially if you're 40 or 50 or 60 years old and you're just now calling upon the name of the Lord. It's going to be a difficult transition for you, but God still wants you to make the transition. He died for you to save your soul. Plain and simple. All you got to do is believe it with your heart, confess it with your mouth, and he'll save you. I want you to stand and bow your heads and close your eyes. I want to give you the opportunity at this time to be saved if you've never accepted Christ as your Savior. And I want you to know it's not that difficult. You say, Brother Morton, it can't be that simple. It is that simple. All you have to do is bow your head in prayer and talk to God. Look, don't just say these words just because you're repeating them after me. Just repeating a prayer isn't going to save you. But I can tell you that what will save you is if you mean them with your heart and you confess them to God. You've got to tell him. And you say, Heavenly Father, I come to you and humble myself before you, admitting to you that I am a sinner. And Lord, I believe with all of my heart that you sent Jesus down to this earth to shed his blood to cancel my sin and to die on an old rugged cross, to be buried and resurrected by you. I believe that with all of my heart. Would you please come into my heart and into my life and save me? I want you to know, with your head bowed and your eyes closed this morning, if you pray a prayer like that to God, not to just be repetitive, something along those lines, and mean it with all your heart, he will save you. There's nothing else you have to do. There's nothing else you can do. You can't be saved by things you do. I think you need to do good things, and I think you need to be baptized, and I think you need to become a part of a church and all of those other things, but those things cannot save you. All that can save you is for you to ask Jesus to come into your heart based upon what he did for you on the cross. If you'll do that, he'll save you. Heavenly Father, God, we come to you this morning. Lord, we thank you for sending your son Jesus to not only die on the cross and be buried, but Lord, on this Resurrection Sunday that we celebrate, that you also raised him from the dead. And because of that, we have a hope of resurrection someday to be with you in heaven. And Lord, we're thankful for that hope. But Lord, I do pray if there's one within the sound of my voice that has never invited you into their heart, that they'll do that today before it's eternally too late. Thank you so much for what you do. Thank you for this precious day that we get to share your gospel of grace with so many other people. And Lord, we ask that you would be with us and that you would bless us now. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen. Thank you so much for joining us again. We invite you back again next Sunday morning as well as Wednesday nights. We also do a live feed on our app. It's Barron Road Baptist Church. That's B-A-R-R with two R's. Barron Road Baptist Church. It's a download. It's a free app you can download and you can pick them all up. Also, on our website at barrenroadbaptist.com, you'll see sermons and devotions. You can pick up those on there as well. Thank you so much for being with us. Have a wonderful Resurrection Sunday. God bless you.